Hi, I'm Tom. I'm an astronomy teacher. I teach physics, astronomy, and meteorology. I've been doing that for 33 years. And one of the wonderful things I have to teach with is a planetarium. This is a planetarium. It's a big dome that this fancy projector projects the stars on. Don't get it confused with an observatory. An observatory is a little different. That's when you have a big telescope that looks out a hole in a big dome at the actual sky. This is different. This is where you project the sky onto that dome so you can see what goes on out there. Okay, the first thing I'm going to show with this planetarium is what today was like. This morning, the sun came up. It came up, you might think it would come up in the east, but actually it came up in the southeast. They don't tell you that usually. And it moved across the sky. It never was overhead. It passed high in the south. And then it started to go down, 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 late in the afternoon. And then as the sun goes down, I'll make it more slow. Sky gradually grows darker, and the stars come out. Now, you might think that's way too many stars. That's an awful lot of stars. You've probably never seen that many. If you're out in the country, though, far, far from city lights, there in fact are this many. And these are just the ones you can see. With telescopes, there are a lot more out there. And all these stars you see right here, in fact, are in our own Milky Way galaxy, and there's billions of other galaxies out there. Anyway, let's point at a few things. Now, you see so many stars up here. I'm reminded of a scene from a movie. You might have seen The Lion King. And the Lion King, Simba and Timon and Pumbaa are sitting out under the stars and full of bugs they've just eaten. And Pumbaa, the warthog, says to Timon the meerkat, "Hey Timon, what are those little sparkly dots up there?" And Timon says, "They're fireflies. Fireflies stuck in that big bluish black thing." Pumbaa then says, "Oh, and I always thought there were balls of gas burning billions of miles away." To which Timon replies, "Pumbaa, with you everything's gas." So there you got two theories about what these little sparkly dots are. Maybe they're little fireflies, lightning bugs, stuck in a big thing up there. Or maybe they're balls of gas burning billions of miles away. Then Simba, the lion, says he heard that the kings of the past are up there looking down on us. Now, if you look up in the sky at night, all on your own with nobody telling you, you'd have no idea what these things were. They could be little fireflies stuck up there. I might have wondered if they're little holes in a big black thing and maybe some light shining through from behind. But people did use their imagination thousands of years ago, and they thought they saw all kinds of things. They thought this was an eagle. They thought this was a lyre. That's not someone who doesn't tell the truth, but an instrument, kind of like a guitar. This was a swan, in case you can't see that. Down here in the south, we have, and there's so many stars it's hard to even keep track of, but we have a scorpion that's just set. We have Sagittarius, the archer. Over here in the east, if you look over here, we have the seven sisters. Soon to rise here is going to be Orion. We have Auriga the charioteer. Now, it's hard to imagine how people saw these patterns. They had quite an imagination. Maybe you could use a little help. Here's what some ancient people thought they saw. They thought they saw Aquarius, the water carrier, pouring out water. Pisces, the fish. Aries, the ram. Here's one that actually looks like what it is. Somebody saw three stars and said, "Hey, that looks like a triangle." For once, I think I agree with them. It's actually an official constellation called the Triangle. Now, here's something. Just the other day, my wife had the TV on, and they were playing an old movie called Clash of the Titans. And in Clash of the Titans, Perseus, the hero, chops off Medusa's head. She's the snake-haired lady who will turn you into stone if you look at her. And he used his shield to look at her reflection and chopped her head off. What was he trying to do? He was trying to rescue Andromeda, whose parents, Cassiopeia and Cepheus, had tied her to a rock so that this sea monster, Cetus, could come up and eat her. But no, Perseus flew up on Pegasus, the flying horse, and rescued her. And then there's a triangle stuck in the middle of it, and a ramp for whatever. So you see all these legends they had going on here. They had quite an imagination. They projected all their mythology and lore into the sky, because what else are they going to do? This is Taurus the bull. Now notice a lot of these are animals. Let me move it on a little bit more here. What else we have? Okay, we have Pisces or fish, Aries is a ram, Taurus is a bull. Okay, a little different. Gemini, the twins. Cancer, the crab. Leo, the lion, kind of like Simba. Okay, after that, Virgo. Oh, I went too fast. Sorry, back where I started. This is Ophiuchus, the witch doctor. He's a snake charmer. We also have Hercules fighting the Hydra. So all these constellations or people's imaginations run wild. Oh, here's Scorpius, the scorpion. Libra, the scales. Now, a lot of those constellations sound very familiar because people say, like, what's your sign? And they usually say one of the ones you just heard. Nobody says, what's your sign? Oh, I'm a Camelopardalis, the giraffe over here. Or I'm an Ursa Major. They always use these, and there's a reason for that that I'll try to show a little bit. But meanwhile, let me turn the constellations off so we can focus some attention on something else. Okay, there they go. And that's daytime again. And if you come over and face north, come over here, and face north, up that way, that'll show something else. The sun goes across the sky, and night comes, and watch what the stars do. The stars all appear to go around like a giant wheel turning. This is why people would have thought there was a big bluish-black thing up there, because it looks like all these things are stuck on some giant rotating sphere. I'm not saying they are. In fact, they're not. But it's all rotating around like this, and there's a star right there above the northern horizon that just sits there, just happens to be right in that spot that doesn't move. That star is called the North Star. People would use it to find their way around at night, and sailors on the ocean could see how high above the horizon it was to figure out their latitude so they could tell where in the world they were. So these motions, notice everything in the sky does this, including, looking back over here, the sun, like a giant wheel. Now for thousands of years, people really thought there was a great big sphere up there turning around. But about 400 years ago, people like Copernicus and Galileo had another suggestion. The Earth is turning. If I spin around like this, I think everybody's going around me. But maybe I'm the one turning. So what you just saw was evidence of the Earth turning on its own axis, and it turns on its own axis once every 23 hours and 56 minutes. Okay. Now what I'm doing, I'm showing the sun at noon. It's December 18th, and you'll see the sun's not very high up in the sky. See, that number tells the number of degrees up above the horizon is. This is at noon. This is the highest the sun gets all day on the 18th of December. And of course, as the day and night go by, sun goes down, stars go flying across, sun comes back up, and it's back in about the same place. But 2 days later after this, December 21st is a special day. It's sometimes called the winter solstice or the first day of winter. It's the day the sun is the lowest down in the south it ever gets. It's the day the sun isn't up very long. And so it's a short, cold day. Now what I can do is I'm going to bring up a line here called the ecliptic. Oops, wrong one. The ecliptic is a line in the sky that shows where the sun is different times of the year. I'm going to skip through a day at a time, a whole day at a time, and you'll see some motions going on. This is like noon every day. And as the days go by, now it's January 1st, you see the sun starting to climb higher in the sky as the days go by. Not only that, you'll also notice the moon. There's a little sliver of a moon. The next day it's over there. The next day it's over there. The next day it's over there. And again, all these are just at noon every day. We go through February, up through March, and then finally, I'll take it all the way up to the opposite time of the year, June, maybe about the 21st or so of June, 26, close enough. On this day, the sun gets way up high in the sky. The rays of it beat straight down. It's a whole lot warmer. And watch what the sun does during the day. It goes across the sky. It sets in the northwest. Stars go by. It comes up in the northeast. It goes down again. All right. Another thing I can show here. You see this beautiful band of light across the sky. I didn't have it on a little bit ago when I was showing the sky. That's the Milky Way. And when I ask my classes, these are mostly like 16, 17, 18 year olds, I ask them if they've ever seen the Milky Way. Most of them don't know what I'm talking about. This beautiful glowing band of light across the sky isn't visible from the city. There's too many lights around. But if you ever go in a really dark place, especially in this case I'm doing June late at night, you'll see it. And it's maybe not quite as bright as it looks here, but close. And it's really the combined light of thousands of stars, not just thousands, millions. In fact, there's about 100 billion stars in the Milky Way. We live in it. All these stars, including our sun, are part of the Milky Way. But when you look up, it's shaped like a giant pancake. So when you look along in the plane of the pancake, you see lots of stars. Now there's a particular thing I've got showing right now, that is the planets. You see the planets all strung along in a line in the sky. The solar system's almost in a plane, kind of like you could draw it all on a piece of paper. There's a reason for that I won't go into now. But as you can see here, this line, this is the sun's path across the sky during the year. And you see it cuts right through the same planets. In fact, I'm going to point something out. First of all, the way to tell a planet apart from a star is that planets wander around. All these stars move in lockstep with each other, all moving the same way. And these objects like Mars, Saturn, Neptune, Pluto, well, they don't call it a planet anymore, but it still wanders around. Jupiter, they don't stay put in their place with respect to the stars. They drift around. They're in different constellations in different years. And something a lot of people don't notice, think about the names of these things that wander around. One of them is the sun. Another is the moon. Another is Saturn. Think about it. Saturn day, sun day, moon day. It's not as obvious with some of the others, but in fact, Tuesday is Mars Day. If you've ever heard of Mardi Gras, that, you know, when they have the celebration in New Orleans, that means Fat Tuesday. Mardi, Mars Day, is Tuesday. In Spanish, it's Martes, which is means Mars Day. So the days of the week were named after the planets because there are seven of them, including the sun and the moon, that you can see with the naked eye. And that's why we have 7 days in the week. So next time it's Sunday, think about what that's named after, or Saturn Day. Anyway, what I can do with this, we can make it like a telescope. I could zoom in on Saturn. If you get a telescope, and there's some telescopes in this room that can do just this, you can see its rings. Now, with telescopes I have here in this room, take out at night and show my students, you do see Saturn at least that good. No telescope on Earth shows it this good, this wall right here, but we've got pictures of Saturn because we've had spacecraft go there. One of them, Cassini, was the name of the spacecraft that went there in 2004, orbited Saturn until September of this last year. It was deliberately plunged into the planet. There's a series of pictures as it dives into the clouds. Also, it has moons. Let's see, Titan is not showing right here, but let me zoom out a little bit. There, Titan. Titan is a very, very strange world. It's almost half the diameter of the Earth, or about a third, and it has lakes, but they don't have water in them. They have liquid methane. and the temperature is about 300 below zero Fahrenheit, and it rains liquid methane, and it falls into mountains made of ice and washes this slushy organic stuff down into basins. We have landed a spacecraft on Titan. We have a picture from the surface of that world, a moon around a planet a billion miles away. And so, to me, the billion or so dollars spent on that spacecraft was money well spent. So I'll zoom out from that. And we'll see what else there is to see. One thing I'll show is the summer constellations. Except I'll show them better than that. Here we go. In the summer, in the night sky, we have constellations like Scorpius, the Scorpion, Sagittarius, who's supposed to be an archer, but he's one of those half-person, half-animal things. In this case, a horse body with a people, the bottom's a horse, the top's a person. It's called a centaur. There's another constellation called Centaurus. Now, here's a funny one. Here we have, what the heck? It is half-goat, half-fish. Its name is Capricorn. It's a sea goat or a mer goat. Ancient people had creative imaginations. They would imagine chopping animals in half and putting them back together wrong. So that's where they got that. So I'll let the night sky go on a little bit again so we can see what else comes out. We have Pisces, the fish coming up again. There's Aquarius, the water carrier. And you see more planets, Neptune, Uranus, and they're all in the same plane like that. All on a plane. Again, there's a good reason for it, which has to do with the way the solar system formed. Here is Eridanus, the River of the Dead, sometimes called the River Styx. If you ever saw the cartoon version of Hercules, you might remember Meg falling in that thing and kind of halfway dissolving. I don't know if you watched that one or not. There's some more things. Orion the Hunter. Orion. Now, you know what? The sun's now up. And the sky didn't get light because I seem to have turned the atmosphere off. I've just brought it back. In fact, let me make that point. I'll stop it for a second, if I can. There we go. In the daytime, the stars are actually out. They're really there. You just don't see them because the air scatters the light and makes the sky all bright. If I take the air out, trying to. There we go. The stars show up again. This is what the sky would look like in the daytime if it weren't for the atmosphere. You would see the stars as long as you shielded your eyes from the sun, which would still be terribly bright over there. Okay, I'm going to show something else now. I'm going to take us on a little trip to see how things are different times of the year. You see, this is June 23rd. I'm going to put the air back here. I'm going to wind time backwards. You'll notice the sun's going to go the wrong way now. You're going to have the sun go eastward across the sky because I can do that with this fancy machine. And I'm going to make it be noon right there. Okay, now what I'm going to do is take us on a little trip. This is June at noon here in Atlanta, and it's summer. Look how high up in the sky the sun is. The sun's almost, but not quite overhead. It rose in the northeast. It got almost overhead. It's going to go down in the northwest. A beautiful, long 14 hours of hot summer sun here in Atlanta. Now I'm going to tell about a little trip I took about 9 years ago. Took a trip to Argentina. Argentina is 5,000 miles south of here on the other side of the equator. And I had a friend I was going to meet down there. And so here's what we did. We got on an airplane and we flew. And this is going to go a lot faster than the airplane. It was actually a 10-hour plane ride, but we're going to cut it to like a minute. Here's what happens as we head south. You see the sun heading north across the sky. We're now down almost to the equator. We're flying over Bolivia, and now we're almost to Paraguay, probably about now. Almost to Argentina, and I'm going to take us to a place called Bahia Blanca, because the sun is completely on the wrong side of the sky. Instead of the sun being in the south like you see it every day here in Atlanta at noon. It's in the north. What's it doing over there? Watch what it does during the day in June in Bahia Blanca. It travels across the sky. Stop that thing right there. It travels across the sky towards the west like it does here. But look, it sets in the northwest and it comes up in the northeast. But look at that. It's a quick, short day with the sun down low. And I've been there and felt it. It's winter in June in South America. And it's cold in June. So this is real and it's strange. Of course, their summer is December. Not only that, let me stop the sky at night and show you something else. Oops. Get around to night. Okay, the constellations. Let's see what kind of constellations they have down south. Different ones. Some of the same ones. You still recognize Scorpius, Sagittarius, they're still out. But look over here in the south. This is a whole different set of constellations, and they're really different. There's a peacock. There's another triangle. There's a square. There's a compass. There's a fly. There's a ship. There's a flying fish, a chameleon, a snake, a toucan, a microscope, a telescope, a furnace. Notice these are completely different sorts of constellations. Instead of being about mythological heroes and, you know, saving damsels in distress chained to rocks from sea monsters, it's a bunch of animals, ships and parts of ships, and technological instruments. That's because these southern constellations were named by people who went sailing far south in about the 1600s. Like Magellan, for example, in 1500, sailed around the southern tip of South America and saw these different sets of stars here. And they named them. And they named them after whatever they were probably holding in their hand. This is a sextant or an octant that was used on a ship to navigate. So somebody looked up in the sky, they saw some stars, they thought, what does that look like? Oh, it kind of looks like this thing I'm holding in my hand. So it's actually a little less creative, perhaps, than the northern constellations that were named a couple of thousand years ago. So that's the southern hemisphere. Now I'm gonna do one more thing. I'm gonna take us back north again. Let me set the latitude there. Okay, we're gonna fly back to the north very fast, but I'm gonna take us past Atlanta. We're gonna go all the way to the North Pole. We're basically at the North Pole now. And I want you to see what the sun does as seen from the North Pole in June. I'll get rid of our constellations because they're a little bit distracting. There they go. By the way, there are no trees at the North Pole. It's in the Arctic Ocean, frozen over. It's all ice all around. You know, maybe Santa's around, but he doesn't have trees. Here's what happens to the sun at the North Pole in June. It does this. If I can get this thing to go. The sun goes around and around. You got to follow it. You got to follow it if you can't. There's the sun going around and around and around. It moves directly to the right. It didn't come up on June 21st or whatever day this is, June 28th. And it's not going to go down. I'm going to speed it up a little bit to show you what it's doing. It goes around and around and around in circles and doesn't go down for 6 months. The sun stays up for a solid 6 months in June. Now what I'm going to do is make the time at the North Pole, we're still at the North Pole here, go on into September. Notice as the day goes by in September, the sunset globe just goes around and around, and the sun doesn't quite go down. But if I keep going with this, if I change the time even more, make it October, November, December, now look what the stars do at the North Pole in December. They just go in circles around you all day long. They don't come up or go down. They just go around in circles. So at the North Pole and at the South Pole, you get 6 months of darkness and 6 months of light straight, with no sunrises and sunsets in between, you know, during the day. So it's a very strange thing. Different places in the world you live, you get different kinds of effects. And at the equator, you hardly have any seasons at all. Okay, I'm going to stop this. And now I'm going to turn the lights on. Okay, now I'm just going to talk a little bit. Okay, I want to explain a little bit about how I got into this. When I was 6 years old, my brother took me up the street to a friend of his who had a telescope and showed me the moon. And I saw the craters, it looked fantastic, and I was riveted by it. So I wanted a telescope for Christmas. And my parents got me a little one, and of course then I wanted a bigger one. I think Santa brought me the next one. And it was more powerful, and so I kind of had telescope fever. And I also got books to let me learn about the stars. For example, here's one that I recommend. It's called The Stars. It's by H.A. Ray. You might recognize the happy font there. He's the author of Curious George. You might not have known he was really into astronomy, and one passion of his was to teach kids about it. So there's this wonderful book from which I learned the constellations. By the time I was 11 years old, I could name most of the bright stars in the sky. I knew them by heart. And then, in my case, I majored in something called physics. It's a science. It's one that brought together my hobbies. Like, I was fascinated with the stars and the weather. I really like snow and tornadoes and all those kinds of things. And so when I took physics, I learned that that's the science that explains these things and helped me understand it. Went to college and I majored in physics. Got a master's degree in physics. And then instead of going into research or government or, you know, actually using the degree for that, I wanted to share this stuff. So I started teaching, and now I've been teaching for 34 years. And I get to teach exactly the things I love like this. Now, you don't, when you study these things, you don't necessarily have to decide it's going to be your career. You might. That's some people's job. There are people who devote their lives to learning this stuff that we know so much about now. How we know that there are gigantic black holes out there devouring stars. How we know that neutron stars slam into each other and create like hundreds of worlds worth of gold in almost an instant. They discovered that just a few months ago. The material in this room, this stuff, was inside of those sparkly dots up in the sky. Sparkly dots up in the sky, stars, suns, gigantic suns, some bigger than our own sun, exploded and scattered these materials out that the Earth is actually made of. It's amazing stuff to learn. It's absolutely fascinating. You could be the person who discovers the next thing like this. You could do what I'm doing and share a passion for it. I just like telling everybody about it. I've always liked telling people things anyway. But you might not do any of that. You might just learn about it and decide it's something that's just a neat part of your life. So you just go out and enjoy it. You can go out in the evening, enjoy your friends, the stars. You can go out and see Orion in the winter over the snow. Then you can, in the summer, see Scorpius down south over the green trees. It's a beautiful thing. We live in a beautiful universe. We know so much about it now because of curious, smart people who devoted their lives to this. So, it's a subject I highly recommend, and thank you for watching. I'm out of the way. Goodbye for now.